Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV original webinar series. To introduce today's topic and speaker, I hand over to our moderator and panelist, Dr. Salim Patel, a consultant orthopedic surgeon from Mumbai.
Thank you, Neeraj. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Ortho TV. Today, we have a very senior, respectable speaker from Ahmedabad. He's none other than Dr. Bharat Dave, sir, a director and a consultant spine surgeon, as well as an institutional head at the Stavya Spine Hospital and Research Institute in Ahmedabad. Sir has done spine fellowships at various centers in Germany, Switzerland, and Belgium. He's been a secretary of Spine Surgeons Association of Gujarat since the last 3 years and organized annual meetings and symposiums, organizing secretary at the ASICON, elected as an AO Spine Indian Educational Officer, has presented over 36 papers in various national and international forums, has 8 publications to his name, written 2 chapters in various journals, as well as performed osteoporosis awareness program through drama with the hospital staff ever since 2011. So today, Dr. Bharat Dave, sir, will be talking about a very interesting topic, which is called as osteosarcopenia and the entire management protocol, the relationship between osteoporosis as well as sarcopenia will be explained by the person who is the best person to speak about this topic. So with this, I would ask Dr. Bharat Dave, sir, to take over the proceedings. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Neeraj, and thank you, Dr. Salim, for inviting me for this interesting topic of my interest and which is bothering all of us in day-to-day activity as well. I'll just share my screen.
Sure, sir.
So the title which we have kept is Fire is On. You may need more info to extinguish it. And what is it? Well, it is sarco-osteoporosis, because we are all aware of the osteoporosis and we know that, you know, osteoporosis is called silent killer. But I think we really need to walk with the fire. We know that, you know, we have the aging population and we really need to attend them and address them. So sarco-osteoporosis, probably what I'm going to explain is an oversimplification of this complex process in my talk. I would say this has been the dictum which we have been using: love me or hate me, but think about me and remember me. And we have been talking about the osteoporosis being the silent killer, but now we have got the sarcopenia added to that, and we have named it a silent sucker because it sucks the muscle and you really do not know whether it is sucking the muscle or not. And that I will explain in my talk. So let's know some facts about the osteoporosis. Well, I think we should identify in the early stage. We should educate the patient and society, and we should have the database in order to treat them, in order to track them and trace them as well. So that, you know, if they are defaulter, we should really make sure that they are able to take the full course, and regular follow-up is must for these cases. And I would say that I'll talk about the sequential therapy for osteoporosis as well. And identifying the defaulters will certainly tame this monster down, and that is osteoporosis. So sarco-osteoporosis, it's like a silent killer, and I would say it's a silent sucker as well. It sucks the muscle, as I mentioned earlier. So the working group of European Society, which has given this definition of sarcopenia, we all know osteoporosis definition, WHO has given -2.5 below the DEXA. Same way, sarcopenia is a syndrome, which is a progressive generalized loss of muscle mass and strength with the risk of adverse outcome like physical disability and poor quality of the life, and eventually becomes a death as well. And muscle mass along with the muscle strength and low physical performance, which gives the sarcopenia the classic definition, which is explained in the European Spine Society. So it is underdiagnosed, it is undertreated, as we all know. When one fragility fracture occurs, second one is on its way, which we always talk to all our patients. Pharmacotherapy for osteoporosis remains the mainstay, along with the pharmacotherapy for osteosarcopenia as well. The available drugs, they target the metabolism, and I would say that's a medical disease, osteoporosis. There are several issues which will certainly have effect in the management of osteoporosis and in the clinical practice, and lack of awareness in the health care provider and the patients, which is very important, which gives the poor adherence to the therapy. So we really need to increase this awareness, and that will provide the safety in the long-term treatment of this monster and the silent sucker. So these are the strategies for secondary prevention care. The minute we have moved out of the secondary prevention, we should be concentrating on the primary prevention care as well, which is being practiced now in the Western world. So what is sequential therapy for osteoporosis? Well, like diabetes and blood pressure, we know that it's an aging, and osteoporosis and the sarco-osteoporosis also, it's an aging too. So I repeat, love me or hate me, but really we need to think about it. And sarcopenia needs an extra attention. And once diagnosed osteoporosis, sarco-osteoporosis, what is required is a lifetime management. And drugs, they have the different action at the different stages of the disease, like osteoclast and osteoblast, both needs to be addressed. And that is where the sequential therapy is important. Initially, you need to fill up the pot, and eventually you need to stop the pot leaking as well by stopping the osteoclastic activity. So giving you the classic example, this 58-year female, we managed to get her pictures from her albums. And as you can see, she's gradually losing her height. And when she ended up, she was below the shoulder height. And if you look at her x-rays, 2007 x-rays show single level vertebral collapse. 2010 November, there were multiple collapse, and eventually ended up with the significant kyphosis when she came to us in 2019 in October with significant loss of the height. So I would say that nowadays, we all should be addressing all our elderly, like what we used to do in the kids, that we used to measure the height at the back of the front door. We should do the same thing for our elderly as well. If they're losing the height, that should ring the bell that yes, this patient or our relative or our elderly person is developing osteoporosis. So could this be prevented? Well, to some extent, yes, because if we have the awareness about this condition, then this can be prevented to a great extent. I'll give you another classic example of female 53, 2001, October, presented with 7 year postmenopause. She had only rib pain then, and there were no other symptoms, and it was diagnosed as acute lumbar strain and treated with the medication only. That was 2001 October, and she was not investigated. Now in 2005, she came again, she had fallen from the table, and you can see that now there was a small little crack into the vertebral body, and the osteoporosis was diagnosed on the DEXA scan, minus 2.3 was the mean DEXA. But she was asked to start alendronate, which is an ideal drug to start with for 2 years, but she stopped after 2 months. And we always investigate these patients with blood test in order to rule out the secondary osteoporosis. So in 2007, so 2 years subsequently, she had fallen in the bathroom and she came on stretcher, and she was not able to sit, and she had significant pain. And here, this time, the DEXA scan was minus 4, so which had moved from minus 2.3 to minus 4. And that is classic scenario which we see in the clinical practice. So in summary, female 59 now, DEXA minus 4 with fragility fracture, without neurodeficit, and with normal blood test. So there was primary osteoporosis postmenopausal in her case. What medications to start? Well, one should consider teriparatide or bisphosphonate or combination, or denosumab. That's what we will discuss in our talk. In 2007, she had this, and she was advised to start teriparatide, but again, she was defaulter, and she did not start teriparatide, or she did not continue for long. She took it for a month only, and then she stopped. And then again, she had the pain in 2014. And as you can see, that there was minus 4 DEXA, which was there, and she this time had no deficit, normal blood test. 2014, she presented again with the fall. As you can see, there was silent fracture here as well. As you can see here, with this silent fracture here, and there was silent fracture here. So this was the old one, L2, and there was L3, which was a silent fracture. So gradually, as I had mentioned earlier, one fracture, second is on its way. She stopped teriparatide on her own. She's continued only for 3 months, which was prescribed in 2007. And she ended up with another fracture. There was no follow-up, and there was L3 silent collapse. This time she had Again, pain was significant. Then she came with the bilateral lower limb pain and she was not able to walk. And on examination, she had quadriceps, they were weak. And as you can see on the MRI, that there was the fluid into the L2 vertebra, which was 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, L1 vertebra, and which was there earlier, which L2 and L3, they had healed. So L1, there was Knudsen sign, you know, the Kamal sign, I would say. And that is something which was there into the osteoporotic vertebral body. And this time she had L1 wedging with neurological deficit. So we ended up treating with management options where surgery only. So we ended up treating with the multi-level fixation. And we started teriparatide and she was advised to continue for 18 months. We always take biopsy when we treat such fracture. We always send the fluid for culture as well. A very important message is here as well. Regular follow-up is advised and she had 1 month follow-up, comfortable residual symptom, D11 to L3, and biopsy proved negative. And here from the pedicle on the left side at L1, we had put the bone graft after doing the laminectomy. So the same bone was put, the vertebral height was restored, and this we call this as open vertebroplasty. 2016, she now has started coming for the regular follow-up. 18 months teriparatide was over, and then she was advised to start alendronate and regular follow-up. And she continued alendronate for 2 years. And subsequently, she was advised to continue denosumab as well. So that's 6 years post-op, and she continued denosumab now. And denosumab, as we know, that it is a safe drug to continue after stopping the bisphosphonate, because bisphosphonate we cannot give. So that's what we will talk in the sequential therapy option. So just see the story. 2005, there was a small little fracture. 2007, it collapsed further. 2014, silent fracture. And 2014, October, there was L1 fracture, which ended up with the neurological deficit. And 2019 had a good, happy scenario at the end. But was this preventable? I'm sure it was preventable. And by increasing the awareness, and that is what we are doing here in this webinar, to educate our society, our patients, our doctors, our fellows, and our orthopedic friends. So message from the case, that identify the disease in the early stage. We need to educate the society. We need to have the regular follow-up. Sequential therapy is must, as it was given in this case. And we really need to catch these defaulters, which is very, very important and will certainly help in fighting this monster. I repeat, underdiagnosis and sequential therapy and poor adherence to the therapy is very, very important to identify early in the disease stage. So secondary prevention, I repeat, I think probably we should be concentrating maybe in next few years, primary prevention care as well. I would say that now the audience is aware, because we are going to discuss about the sequential therapy. So the audience is aware that osteoporotic is a medical management. Postmenopausal women have the vertebral and the hip fracture. BMD value, T-score, we know that the osteopenia is -1 to -2.5. And 10-year risk can be measured for this osteoporotic fracture by the FREX, fragility score. And that is available on the net, and our Indian data is available as well. So that should be used widely in all the clinic. That will give us the 10 years probability of the fracture in the DEXA scan. And we all should be giving vitamin D and calcium supplement to all these patients. So coming to the normal bone metabolism. We all know that osteoclasts are important in order to stimulate the osteoblastic activity. And this is the normal cycle. And we all should know about the RANK, which is the receptor, and RANK ligand is the something which is giving the signaling. And that is where, you know, the osteoclast forms because of this. And that the drugs will act at different stages. So coming to that, if I put this here as, it takes 3 weeks for the bone resorption to take, but but it takes 13 weeks for the bone lay down. So meaning osteoblasts, they take long time, and the osteoclast eats the bone very fast. That is where we really need to act on this particular area, where if you give teriparatide, has to be given for long term in order to have the osteoblastic stimulation and laying down of the bone, while the osteoclastic suppression like bisphosphonate that will act on the receptor, denosumab that will stop the osteoclast formation acting on the RANK and RANK L ligand receptor, and they will certainly not allow to form this, and this will lead to apoptosis of the osteoclast. So both these will certainly control the osteoclastic activity, but I repeat, we need to fill up the pot with osteoblastic activity in the form of teriparatide. And this is reversible. Well, to some extent, both the activities are very, very important and needed. So coming to the basis of the medications, these are the osteoclast and osteoblast formation. And that is where we really need to learn about osteoblastic activity and osteoclastic suppression to follow. That is the sequential therapy meaning. We have in this study, in this talk, I have included EXPOS, FACT, VERO, HORIZON, and AVA studies, and I have taken a lot of extracts from these studies. Clinical practice. So coming to that, we know that osteoporosis, it's a lifetime disease. Sarco-osteoporosis, again, it's a lifetime disease, because once the muscle mass is lost, you cannot rebuild the same muscle mass which was there at the age of 35. So what we should be considering is the management in toto about the sarco-osteoporosis. We should be talking about the clinical risk factor, and we should consider this postmenopausal women and elderly gentlemen as well. We should be considering the clinical risk factor in the management of osteoporosis. Very important. There are several factors like previous fracture, parents, they have the fracture. Secondary causes of osteoporosis should be considered as well. Like somebody who is on the anti-epileptic drugs, they can cause osteoporosis. Even the drugs like clopidopril, they also cause osteoporosis as well. So that list of drugs which causes osteoporosis is gradually increasing with the awareness of the clinicians. So suggested investigation in order to rule out secondary osteoporosis is serum calcium level, serum vitamin D level, PTH, TSH, and now added is PSA for the male patient, particularly very important in sarcopenia management. Serum protein again is very important in the sarcopenia management as well. And creatinine clearance is very important in order to identify sort of drug dosage for the osteoporosis management. And last but not the least, and the most important, which is the investigation available in our armamentarium, is the DEXA scan. And that is usually we take the spine and hip DEXA into the account. The bone turnover markers, I have put it a really, big font. We normally do not use it, because it has to be taken at a particular time with a particular lab as well. And so we are not giving too much importance to that, because it's too expensive as well. Coming to the drug therapy, sequential therapy, teriparatide is something which is the only anabolic drug available which stimulates the osteoblast, and it should be given it for 18 months. Bone remodeling happens, and it is something which is positive side is the stimulation. It should be given to improve the bone architecture. It not only forms the trabecular, but it also forms the cortical bone as well. And I will say that this is a miracle molecule. Previously, we used to do about 8 to 10 vertebroplasty in a month. Now, because of this molecule extensive use, we only do one vertebroplasty in 6 months. So the patient comes, fracture is diagnosed, immediate secondary osteoporosis is ruled out, and we start the teriparatide. And that certainly forms the bone, and it certainly relieves the pain in a month's time. The negative is it is a parenteral subcutaneous injection. The cost is again a major bar, and it has to be given once in the lifetime. That's what the recommendation is, 18 to 24 months. Compliance is a major issue. Adherence to the treatment, and the cold chain has to be maintained and a particular time duration has to be given. Biosimilars, I think I'm sure you know it has its own advantage, which are, you know, relatively less expensive. And I would say that apple and oranges are not the same. So we should really, in the initial phase, maybe one can consider the biosimilar as well. Malignancy has to be ruled out. Once the patient is known to have malignancy, so any other origin, I think probably we cannot give teriparatide because it's a hormone. Serum calcium level and serum PTH level has to be normal. If the serum PTH level is high, we cannot give teriparatide. Serum calcium level is likely to shoot up. So if patient has got the hypercalcemia, we better correct it by giving vitamin D or whatever. The reason for the hypercalcemia need to be diagnosed. And after it becomes normal, then only we can give teriparatide. So these are the limitations of teriparatide. And it improves, as I mentioned, you know, it improves the both cortical and cancellous bone. Bisphosphonates, they are most commonly used. It increases the matrix mineralization and it increases the bone density to a certain point. It cannot restore the lost structure, but it improves the microarchitecture and it closes the resorption pits by attacking the osteoclast. It suppresses the osteoclast. It does not stimulate the osteoblastic activity. Compliance and persistence of therapy are generally poor. We have to give this bisphosphonate for quite some time. I would say maybe for 5 years. That's what the recommendation is. Positive side, it's a cost-effective drug. Oral and IV are available. IV available are 3 months or 1 year. Zoledronic acid, we can give it for yearly therapy. Alendronate is one of the most effective drug, oral therapy. And drug holiday has to be followed. Some people say 3 years, some people say 5 years. But I would make note here that there are people, there are patients who are on secondary prevention due to rheumatoid. They keep on taking this medicine. So they have to be warned that, you know, there is a drug holiday for this particular bisphosphonate. And creatine clearance is very important. We really need to test the creatine clearance before we start bisphosphonate. Negative side effect, probably it causes osteonecrosis, jaw necrosis, and atypical fracture. Patient compliance, again, it's a major, not that major issue, but yes, patient has to take it empty stomach and has to walk around, cannot lie down, otherwise it will cause the gastric and the esophageal ulcer. So it really informs the trabecular. Now, coming to the real scenario, teriparatide we can give from 18 to 24 months, once in lifetime, cannot give in the malignancy. And serum calcium level, serum PTH level has to be normal. And it's a red level drug. But that is something which we should really, when patient nowadays comes to us, the minute you talk about teriparatide, they'll come and say, doctor, this is a red level drug. So we have to really give them time. We have to explain them. It was double the dose. It was 3 years and it was in the red. It has never been observed in the human individuals at the moment. And cost, again, it's a major issue. Bisphosphonate, 5 years. Drug holiday, oral or IV, and jaw necrosis. Coming to the denosumab, which is the relatively newer molecule in our country, and safety for 10 years has been tested. And we have to give it every 6 months. And it is safe in malignancy as well, but it is a subcutaneous injection. But like bisphosphonate, and if you miss the dose of denosumab, the osteoclast will start eating the bone and it will give osteoporosis sooner than compared to the teriparatide and bisphosphonate. So denosumab, if one is given, one is prescribed, you really need to warn the patient that do not stop the bisphosphonate, the denosumab for 10 years. Combined therapy, well, I think, is it like, you know, if you do 1 plus 1 is equal to 2? It is never so. Combined therapy is something which is not an addictive effect. Yes, maybe some addictive effect. You can say that 1.25% may be an additive effect. So once the pot is filled with teriparatide, osteoblastic activity is continued, then afterwards, if stopping the teriparatide, one can continue denosumab or one can start the bisphosphonate. But generally, denosumab, if it is given, then teriparatide starting is not recommended. That's what the literature says. And I will narrate a couple of articles in the same as well. So just a simplistic way, that when there is high risk fracture, when there is one fragility fracture, when the dexa is less than minus 2.5, one fragility fracture has occurred, then I think this is the treatment chart we should follow along with oral calcium and vitamin D. We start teriparatide followed by either bisphosphonate or denosumab. Bisphosphonate 5 years and then drug holiday, denosumab 10 years. At the moment, good outcome has been observed for 10 years. So this is the disclaimer. I would say it is one of the treatment options which we use at our Stavir Spine Hospital. Diagnosed early, better managed with the oral and IV medications. And I think you can say that decandidabolin is something which needs to be addressed, particularly when we are talking about the silent sucker. I'm talking about the sarcopenia. So this is an anabolic molecule which is injectable available. It increases the weight, but it should not be given in prostate cancer. And hence PSA has to be done into the pre sort of the treatment therapy diagnosis, secondary osteoporosis and sarcopenia evaluation. It is not widely used, but currently we are doing the study on decandidabolin as well in order to see the efficacy of both the drug or single only the bisphosphonate. This particular article mentions the 10-year denosumab therapy, which is giving good outcome without major side effects. So what is more important in Bone 2020, the drug therapy is important. And what it concludes that the clinical effectiveness of denosumab, raloxifene, romosumab, teriparatide for prevention, a systemic review. They had more than 7,000 cases evaluated. And they say that compared to the placebo therapy, it certainly helps in prevention of the fracture. So we have something in our armamentarium. We have something to treat this particular condition, this particular monster, to tame it down in the form of different drugs. And it is a lifetime disease. Once diagnosed, we really need to continue medications as well for the lifetime, like the blood pressure and diabetes. So after stopping bisphosphonate, one can continue the safely the another drug called the denosumab. So we should really continue that for another 10 years. So atypical fracture doesn't occur. And denosumab, if you stop, then we can start the bisphosphonate. So basically, by filling the pot and by allowing not to dribble the bone loss, and that can be controlled by controlling the osteoclastic activity. So do we really stop medications? Perhaps never. We have to continue vitamin D and calcium along with this. We keep checking BMD yearly and keep monitoring this. This is the classic sort of, if you look at this right-sided, the glomerular filtration rate. And if it is less than 35, we really need to be careful about administering. And same way, denosumab appears again the safe here as well. So in minus one or above that, one can give bisphosphonate and vitamin D calcium. If it is osteopenia, we can give bisphosphonate. When it is severely osteoporotic, one may want to give teriparatide to begin with, followed by denosumab or bisphosphonate or either vice versa. So same repetition here, combined therapy, 1+1 is equal to not 2, and we should really keep working on this as well. So love me or hate me, but think about me and remember me, that is silent killer, and I would say silent sucker as well, the sarcopenia. Coming to few more sarcopenia talk. Well, I think it increases with the age. There is no difference between men and women. 1 to 29% of the older community, up to 30% in the women, this is what is the prevalence, and 14 to 33%, up to 68% into the men, those who are in the long-term care institutes, they are the one which are affected. So sarcopenia is something which we should not neglect. And coming to the real definition, which I mentioned earlier as well, low muscle mass, which happens with the age, either with the low muscle strength or with the low physical performance, that is the sarcopenia. And that leads to the frequent fall and frequent thing. Impact of sarcopenia, 25%. If you look at the 65 years of the age, 25% muscle mass is lost. But when you look at the age 80, 60% muscle mass is lost. So the muscles are not going to be as capable as they were in the younger age in order to hold the body erect. And along with the osteoporosis, they make life even difficult as well. Here, how do we diagnose? DEXA is something which is very important in order to diagnose this. And I would say, look at the classic example here. Is the age 63, the muscle mass of the femur is significantly low. Same way, you can see the MRI of the spine, where you can see the fatty infiltration of the paraspinal muscles, which is quite evident here. And this is how we can diagnose. The look at the psoas, which is rudimentary at places as well. So very important that the psoas, the muscle mass, and you can see here in the femur as well, this is classic the sarcopenia. So we should be considering sarco-osteoporosis or sarcopenia-osteoporosis. Age-related bone muscle, bone loss, quality and strength has reduced. Same way, muscle loss, quality and strength has reduced. And that will lead to fall, fracture, morbidity, and eventually mortality. How do we test sarcopenia? We have the grip strength. We also have the pinch test. And we also have the six-minute walk. And this also helps in diagnosing the osteopenia as well. We have the DEXA machine, which checks the full DEXA study. So that certainly tells us how much is the fat in each limb, how much is the fat in the tummy, and how much is the muscle as well. So this really helps us in identifying the sarcopenia as well. So in conclusion, to identify in a precise way osteoporotic fracture, who is at the risk, we really consider the clinical risk factor. To treat this condition and fragility fracture, drug has to be continued with the strong evidence that it helps. High risk patient has to be identified. New pharmacological approach, which I mentioned in the sequential therapy, has to be continued. Compliance is very important. Long-term therapy, lifetime therapy has to be substituted. The issues remain unresolved in osteoporosis management. And what is that? Again, same adherence to the treatment by the healthcare worker. Resistant osteoporosis. We have seen few patients where nothing works and patient keep on losing the bone mass, which is very important to consider. Atypical fracture, jaw necrosis. These are the two things when we look at the bisphosphonate therapy. So they again are the unsolved therapy and unsolved issue. Parental root and the cost again is an issue as well in the management of osteoporosis. Our Indian data, where we have limitation for our society and the compliance to the patient as well. So these are the limitations of our Indian data. Studies mentioned, they also have limitation, I would say. I'm not sure whether they were all sponsored studies and they may be biased as well. But what we have been seeing in our clinical practice in day-to-day scenario, when we give teriparatide, in a month time, patient's pain disappears. We have seen reduction in the collapse of the bone. So my message is identify this disease in the early stage. We really need to educate the society and our patient. We should be concentrating on the full course of the therapy, starting from teriparatide and ends with denosumab or bisphosphonate, along with the calcium vitamin D to continue. Long-term therapy has to be and regular follow-up is must. Sequential therapy has to be sort of discussed with the patient. We should make them aware that this is very important. Identify the defaulters, and we should really tame this monster and stop this sucking our muscles. And we can say that it is sarcopenia. It's a lifetime disease. One fracture occurs, second is on its way. Before starting the therapy, we really need to rule out the secondary causes of osteoporosis like multiple myeloma. We should be aware of the drug side effects, which I mentioned for the teriparatide, we cannot give into the malignancy. And compliance is very, very important. And each drug has its own duration. And that is to be kept in mind because we still are not aware of the long, long, long lifetime treatment therapy as well. Hopefully the research is going on and we may be able to have a molecule which we can give it for the lifetime. So that's the last slide. Ideal and what is the caveat? So ideal is vitamin D and oral calcium. But if vitamin D is given in high dose, overdose is not something which is we should be unaware of. It can cause fatigue, muscle mass, vomiting, all those things can happen with hypervitaminosis. It is a fat-soluble vitamin, So if it gets deposited, it's very difficult to have it out as well. It takes few weeks, maybe longer duration for vitamin hypervitaminosis D to treat. Vitamin D along with that calcium. The cardiologists, sometimes they say you should not take calcium medication. But then at the same time, they give the clopidogrel as well. So that is very important. That is the caveat. You know, we should be balancing the two. Teriparatide, maximum you can give it for 2 years. Repeat dose, we have seen in the clinical practice, repeat dose has been given by many of us. So it is very important that we have to continue osteoclastic suppressant after stopping the teriparatide therapy. Denosumab, 10 years data is available, but on discontinuing, even a month or two is overdue of this denosumab, it will, BMD will drop. Bisphosphonates, we should be giving it for 5 years, maybe 3 years, depending upon the drug holiday is very important. Otherwise, pathological fracture will occur. And combination therapy, well, evidence is positive, but not really foolproof. So coming to that sarcopenia, muscle strength to maintain, vitamin D, an anabolic drug like dacarbolin has a major role to play in sarcopenia as well. The muscle loss can be prevented to some extent. And most important for both this condition is the awareness, and the facility in the house has to be sort of tailor-made according to the need of an individual. So fall prevention is very important along with the awareness. Thank you very much for your patience hearing. Now we can have the question answers. Thank you.
Yeah, Neeraj, you want to start?
Yes. So, sir, that this new protocol which you showed basically is completely opposite of what we have been following, that when the patient is detected first time osteoporosis, we usually start them on alendronate and then we take them to zoledronic acid, or then we take them to denosumab, and then eventually we take them to the last one, which is teriparatide. We always keep teriparatide as a reserve, but you are saying that we should start with teriparatide and then go to the other ones. So any particular reason for this?
Yeah, because you see, when we have diagnosed that they have osteoporosis, if you consider that the pot, which is already empty, meaning the bones, they are empty. And if you do not fill it up, and if you stop, you know, the draining out, then it's not going to work. So we really need to fill it up. So osteoblastic activity has to be instituted first in the, you know, by the drug called teriparatide. And once we have filled the pot, then we should stop the osteoclastic, you know, suppression we should give. So that is the real reason, you know, we should be starting with the teriparatide.
And besides cancer, what is the other contraindication of giving teriparatide?
Well, mainly the hyperparathyroidism. Secondary hyperparathyroidism due to vitamin D and calcium lack. That is where we really need to look at that as well. So what normally we follow in our clinical practice, if the PTH is high, we try to find out what the level is. We sometimes go for the PTH scan, parathyroid scan as well. And we don't get surprised. We get every 6 months one parathyroid adenoma. And that is something, you know, it happens in the younger or, you know, slightly around 40, 50 years of the age as well. And that is the secondary cause. And the minute you treat that, osteoporosis will vanish. So teriparatide, again, you know, it's a sort of low dose therapy. And if it is a high dose, then it causes osteoporosis. In a low dose, it stimulates the bone.
And is the DEXA scan more reliable when starting teriparatide? Will you always do the DEXA scan before starting teriparatide, or you will do even if there is a fragility fracture came to you?
No, DEXA scan, not necessarily. If there is one fragility fracture, DEXA scan may be deceptive. So normally what we do, we go for the hip and the spine DEXA. If one of them is negative, then we certainly consider that as a follow-up therapy, DEXA scan. So 1 year we do that. And if it is not falling, then we say, okay, patient is taking medication and the drug is acting. And we really try to, you know, push the patient and we really educate the patient. So very important that we have to have both done. So DEXA scan is not very important when there is fragility fracture, but we must rule out the secondary cause of osteoporosis.
Okay. About the fragility fracture also, most of us will start some form of treatment when a patient comes with an IT fracture or when a patient comes with a spine fracture. But many of the general orthopedic surgeons will defer starting any kind of treatment when they have just come with a colles fracture. Simple, where they have just done a close reduction and put in a plaster. But actually, I feel that that is the right time to start, because then you're going to prevent the spine and the hip fractures. What is your take on that?
Yeah, so that is what I said. Now, one fracture has occurred, second is on its way. So that message has to be clearly given to the patient. That will certainly help to build the skeleton, which is very important. So I would say that, you know, no harm in starting. Yes, when we look at these spinal fusions, some people, there is two opinion. Some people say we should not be giving bisphosphonate in the immediate post-operative phase while the osteoblastic activity is going on. And after that, we should stop the osteoclastic activity. So that is sometimes we follow after 6 weeks, maybe 2 months, we start the alendronate. But before that, we may give, you know, if you are worried about fusion part.
Okay. And when do you start the calcium and vitamin D?
Well, that... I think calcium and vitamin D is the mainstay of the treatment. We really should be starting calcium and vitamin D. And nowadays, calcium citrate malleate, which is something, you know, which is quite widely acceptable molecule now. So we should give calcium citrate malleate. And we also give vitamin D. Initially, we used to check vitamin D. But nowadays, you know, if you give vitamin D, because the test itself is expensive, but the therapy will be even cheaper. So what we normally do, once a week therapy, 60,000. And then afterwards, we give once a month. And then if patient is really well educated, we give once a 6 months even. Then that is to be continued for the lifetime.
Okay. So, and about this early detected osteoporosis. So what happens is that, okay, now patient has been come to you at the age of say 58, 60, and patient has been detected with osteoporosis. And then you start him on teriparatide, start her on teriparatide, because I am hoping that she will be a female. She on an average, our life expectancy nowadays has gone up, and the patient may live up to 80 or 90 or even.
Yeah.
So you finish the teriparatide in the first 2 years. By the time it's 60, she cannot take any more teriparatide.
Yeah.
Then if she has a fragility fracture after 10 years, what do we do?
No, that's what I'm saying. So if you have started after stopping teriparatide, if you have started bisphosphonate or denosumab, then that is not likely to happen. That is one. Second thing, we have quite a few of us when we discuss in the meetings, you know, we say that if required, we certainly occasionally in few cases, we have started second, the teriparatide as well, the second course. So I would say that we have to make patient aware that after stopping teriparatide, even they stop after 6 months, 1 year, because they cannot afford, then also they should really switch over from teriparatide to bisphosphonate or denosumab.
Okay. Over to you, Salim.
Yeah, thanks. Excellent talk, sir. Absolutely crisp and bang on the target. So my question for you is like what you said, for every osteoporotic spine fracture, you like to go ahead with a biopsy just to rule out any malignancies or anything. So, sir, you usually do a transpedicular biopsy and you're using a Jamshedji needle for that procedure or anything else other than that?
Yeah. Initially, we had one biopsy needle which we had devised, which had the serrations at the end and which we used to make about, 4 millimeter core. So, if we are doing it open biopsy, then we use that. But for the closed biopsy, we use a Jamshedji needle.
Jamshedji.
Because you know, it has got a diameter of maybe around 2 millimeter only.
2 millimeters. Right, yeah. Right. And so then you plan a vertebroplasty immediately on table at the same time?
Yeah. So if it is a fragility fracture, which has not united with the posterior cortex intact, no deficit, and the fluid which we aspirate, afterwards we go for the vertebroplasty.
Okay.
But again, we always send that fluid for the culture immediately.
Right. Excellent, sir. Next question is, sir, osteoporosis, the entire fraternity is aware of. What are the management lines? As like you have explained everything so in a very precise manner. About sarcopenia, sir, what do you think? How much is important that awareness of sarcopenia should be there, especially among the upcoming orthopedic surgeons? Because many of them are not aware or they don't even look into it, that this could be a very high-risk condition.
Yeah.
Your comments on that, sir.
Yeah. The sarcopenia is something which should come into the limelight soon now, because sarcopenia and osteoporosis both are going to give the fall to the patient. Which one does first, we do not know. Like, you know, egg and the chicken. So same way, we should be treating sarcopenia equally well as much as we are giving importance to osteoporosis. And for that, the most important molecule is vitamin D. Vitamin D is considered to be the millennial molecule, vitamin D miracle molecule. So something like that, you know, vitamin D has to be given. Something which is happening in the overall surrounding overall environment, which is certainly reducing the vitamin D. Means why should we have vitamin D low? You know, we means, you know, those who are working outside.
Right.
You know, our workers, but still many of them, they have low vitamin D. So right. Something like that, you know, we do not know what is happening. Maybe absorption. And another thing, vitamin D 60K is not always 60K. The shelf life of that drug has, you know, there was a study from the New Zealand. It contained from 6,000 to 80,000 IU vitamin D, although, you know, it was labeled as 60K.
Right, right.
So something which is very important. So I would say my message for sarcopenia diagnosis is very important. And for that, what we really need to look at is the DEXA scan. DEXA scan, full DEXA scan will certainly identify the sarcopenia. We are doing the study for the same as well. And they should be given with decadirabolin. Even male, female, both can be given decadirabolin. But we really need to make sure that the PSA is normal.
Right. So, sir, with decadirabolin, you will supplement calcium and D3 as well?
Obviously.
And what about alendronate, sir? Would you keep it in the same group or separately?
No, we give it, because if there is osteoporosis diagnosed, then we certainly add the alendronate.
You certainly add the
alendronate. We have to treat both at the same time.
Right, sir. So your comments on the newer generation today of orthopedic surgeons, their inhibition to prescribe an anabolic steroid. What would you think? I mean, they usually, when you talk about steroids, the mind always goes towards catabolic, not anabolic. So yeah. Your comments on that, sir. How do we create an awareness for that?
Well, I think that this webinar, probably, you know, something like this, we should be really doing it more frequently, maybe, or we should be really, you know, educating them as well. And maybe more awareness to the patient. I would say in our clinic, we have posters, big posters, you know, put in there as well. So that increases the awareness. Same way for our colleagues, for our friends, you know, we should be doing webinars. We should be educating them about the anabolics as well. And we have to really, you know, increase that awareness in order to tame this. I would say today only we use this word sucker, sarcopenia, you know, silent sucker. It sucks the muscle.
Absolutely.
It loses the muscle, you know, muscle mass shrinks.
Absolutely. Right, sir. Thank you. Excellent, sir. Yeah, Neeraj, any other questions from your end?
Thank you very much.
Yeah,
thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for
allowing me to share my knowledge, my presentation, and the way we practice. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone, and
bye.
Good night.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.